Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, our Holy Trinity, to him be glory forever and ever. Amen. Since I can remember, and I am 75 years old, the doctrine of the Trinity has been my number one concern. Whatever has been published in any language that I can use, I immediately acquire and read. This does not necessarily make me an expert. No one can call himself, I am an expert on the Trinity, because we're dealing with the mystery of the divine being. I like to avoid the word existence. I prefer being. Though Christos Yannaras, one of our modern Greek theologians, said very often that in proper Orthodox theology, there is no difference between being and existence in God. Both words refer to the one reality of the divine being. So I'm not expert. I'm just still looking, still reading, still doing my research, especially in the Arabic language, because this is the area where Muslims in Egypt and throughout the Arab-speaking communities like to charge us with tritheism, three gods. Their criticism starts with the denial of the incarnation as an impossible act, and it goes on to Father, Son, and sometimes they say Father, Son, and Mother, because the word spirit is feminine, and they think that Christ is a byproduct of a marriage between God and the woman. And that has been stated in the Quran, actually. Very, very sad, but never mind. This is not my concern tonight. My concern tonight is focused on one item from Cyril, John of Damascus, and Origen of Alexandria, and Saint Athanasius, that the divine being is perfect, complete. And the perfection of God in Christian theology is highlighted by the fatherhood of God. And the fatherhood of God is the Greek word pegi, means fountain, origin. And that's actually the meaning of the word ab in Aramaic and even in Hebrew, maybe in Old Arabic, but not in Modern Arabic. Ab, origin. So we have the origin, the fountain of life. It goes back to the second letter of Saint Athanasius, which is Rabion, on the Holy Spirit. From Athanasius, one can draw the best Trinitarian theology. Of course, it becomes more elegant and more applied to the life of the Church in the writings of Saint Cyril of Alexandria. So we have the origin. We have the revelation, which is the Son, and we have the gift. And the gift, according to Taylor of Bathier, Saint Augustine, and even Saint Cyril, is the name of the Holy Spirit, is the gift that God gives to us, to creation. So the perfect being of God is, God has a source of life, the Father, who gives his life to the Son and his life to the Spirit. We use two words here, regeneration and procession, in order to highlight the distinction. The Father of the Church, especially Saint Basil, in his letter to Amphrochius and later fathers also, maintain the distinction between persons, because that distinction is absolute necessity for a proper understanding of the divine life. So why there is origin, revelation, and the gift? The answer is, this is what we call the economia, the plan of salvation. That the generation of the Son, specifically using the word Son, is the very foundation of our adoption. That God revealed Himself in this way in order to accommodate our communion and to give us a share in the life of His Son. That's why the Son came to reveal the Father and came to give the Spirit. He points to the Father and to the Spirit as the mediator, the one who gives. And the giving takes place by the Spirit. There is that gift of the Spirit, Koinonia, at the end of the second letter to Corinth. The love of God the Father, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Spirit. He gives us this communion in order to make us the image of the Son. And here in the vocabulary of the New Testament and the Fathers of the Church, we hear of the Son as the image of the invisible God. Image here means that the Father is the origin of the Son. Even when we speak of the saints and we have the icons are image, but the saint is the origin. Revelation here is a revelation of the Son. In order that we may enter into this relationship by the Holy Spirit as children, as adopted children. This is the perfect being of the divine life. This is God. Any creature does not have a source of life in him or in it, like the material world. I don't have a source of life in me. If I do, then I am God, but I don't. I will never die if I have a source of life in me. And we have in history and in life the fingerprints of the Trinity. Because we look for a revelation, which is the relationship. We reveal ourselves to each other in the dialogue, in the common life that we share. And then we exchange gifts. But gifts are not really our own being. The great difference between the Father sending the Paracletos, the Holy Spirit, in order that we may receive life. This is not the same as when we have Christmas gifts. I don't give my life. If I give my life as a gift to anyone, I will die, certainly. If I give my heart as a donation to someone who has a heart problem, then I certainly suffer this. But God is immortal, does not suffer death. You cannot cut part of God or divide Him. Division belongs to creation, belongs to the fallen nature also. So, it's very important for us to see how the Trinity is leaving traces of His being in creation. And how we are, in a sense, images of that life, the divine, perfect life. We lack the source of life. But we don't lack the communion, which is in a sense is a revelation. But we lack the gift. Oh, we can give cars, motor cars, we can give buildings, we can give money, we can give books. But when it comes to life, we can't. That's why we are the image of Christ. The origin is different. The origin has life, which makes him say, I am life, I am the resurrection, I am the one who gives you eternal life. And I'll send the Spirit from the Father, so that you may receive the Spirit, and from the Spirit you will know me. So, my dear brothers and sisters, the Trinity is given to us as a doctrine of the plan of salvation. We are bogged by three in one and one in three. But you know, numbers are not the best way of defining things. The Trinity is three in one and one in three. This is about revelation. It's not about definition. You can't define God. We can tell. This is his life. How he is and how he acts. The Trinity is about how he is and how he acts. And because of that, we look back and say that the Trinity has accommodated for us four things. Number one is that we are given communion with God through the Son and by the Holy Spirit. It's the most practical doctrine ever about the divine being. And here I have to warn you that apologetic writings on that topic has actually mutilated the topic. We cannot, by apologetic arguments, explain anything, because it's not something that is offered to look at. It's not something that is offered to look at. It's something that is offered for us to participate. And when we participate, we start to know it. Number two, it's a doctrine of the evolution of our human race, from slavery to sonship, from mortality to immortality, from being slaves to being children. And that is not something that we produce. It doesn't come from a system. Neither it is self-produced, but it comes from God. More important, when we speak about our renewal, is that throughout human history, heretics, I believe very much that Arianism is still alive with us. You know, you read commentaries and books written by some great people. Underneath their presentation, there is the Arian theology of God, the who is far away and cannot be approached. God who gives us external things, doesn't give us himself. We are afraid to receive the divine life, because if we receive the divine life, it actually demands a change of life. And so we have to work out in a clever way how to minimize. Yes, We do it because we look at its immense implications and turn our back. That is a major problem. Number four, and it's my last point because I have taken so much time with you. It's not only something that we know and experience. It's something that we love in order to know. It has reversed the process of our human life. There is a lot of sayings in the Desert Fathers and in our theologians that as a result of mortality, as a result of the fall, we start with knowledge, hoping to reach love. But in the Bible, in the Fathers, the beginning or the starting point is love that leads to knowledge. But love here is not feeling. It's not something that we imagine, romanticize. Love here is going back to the reality of the human person. We do not exist, and we cannot exist without love. Either to self-love in its extreme form and narcissism, or love in the family, or love of our work, love of our research, love of our friends, love of the food, love of the way we are dressed. There is love that permeates everything in our life. And when we fail in love, our knowledge gets twisted. Also, when we fail in knowledge, our love gets twisted. Because, you know, you cannot separate love from knowledge. But when you start with knowledge without love, sorry, this is bad news. It's demonic. The one who wanted to know, but not to love. But the one who wanted to love in order to know and to learn in a different way is the one who has the wisdom to experience and to come close to the very being of the person. We are friends. I cannot discover you by analyzing you. I can discover you by loving you, and then if I want to analyze you, I may analyze you later on. We are not aware of how love actually is involved in every single life. Even when we are afraid for our bodies, because we love our bodies. We drive carefully in order not to be killed, which is fine, because we love our bodies. We take care of our health because we love life. So I always say, argue with my non-Christian friends, the missing part is like, you know, jigsaw. The piece of jigsaw that is missing in our teaching of the Trinity is love. You have a picture, but there are a very big piece in the middle, which doesn't make the picture very clear to us. It is for love that God revealed himself, the source of love, the spring of love in Saint Athanasius, and the revelation of love in the Son, and the gift of love is in the Spirit. Love that is triune, origin, revelation, and gift. And in this circle of Trinitarian love, we should discover the depths of the divine being. Thank you very much for being patient with me. And we complete the topic next Tuesday, the Lord is willing. And may the Lord be with you. Christ is risen.